number 8.
I gave my life for thee.
What hast thou done?
Independent Missionary Baptist Church in El Cajon, California. And I want to share with you just a little bit about what God is doing out there so that you can continue to pray for the work. God is blessing. About 3 years ago or so, I was here and I announced to the church that I would be starting a new church in Lakeside, California. And you all graciously voted to take me on for support. Another church also from this area agreed to take me on for support. Got back out to California, and my wife said to me, "We'd really like to have you go to this church over here." So we went there, and on the way home, she asked me, "What do you think about that church?" And I said, "It's dead in the graveyard at 4 o'clock in the morning." Wow. And you know, the sad part about that is that that's becoming about 90% of the churches around are deader than a graveyard at 4 o'clock in the morning. There's no life in them because the preachers aren't preaching the Word of God. Now, this guy was preaching the Word of God, but he was dying also, and it was a very difficult thing for him to be able to really spend a lot of time studying and put much emphasis on the Word as he preached and what have you, and the church was dying right along with him. When we did join the church eventually, and when we did, we were not only the youngest ones there, and I was 64 at the time, but we were also number 6 and 7. That was it. So we were actually smaller than you folks. And it didn't take but only about 6 months or so, and he died. And so now we're down to 6. And a few months after that, a lady left the church. And now we're down to 5. And a few months after that, now it's more like a year or so after that, the couple that was oldest in the church, he was 81, she was 86, they left. Now we're down to 3. With not much coming in. The building was atrocious. It was so dark in there when you walked in the door at night. It was like looking, I think Abe Lincoln had more light than what we did. Really, it was bad. So we were able to buy some lights, put some lights in, painted the ceiling white, painted the walls white. They were dingy yellow from age and what have you, you know how they get. And did a little work in there. Then we talked the church into buying some windows, and a few more folks started coming, and a couple that was there on just a temporary basis provided a lot of monies for the windows of the church. We put the windows in, and before I finished up the windows, I looked at the walls in the church, and the walls were not just were they off in color, they were horrible. They were made out of this real flimsy material. I leaned on the wall like that one day, and my hand went right through it. So it was a bunch of old stuff that wouldn't hold up. So I talked to church into letting me insulate the church and put sheetrock up. So we did that. And little by little, we're trying to make some improvements to the building and trying to preach the Word of God and encourage folks to come. In November of that year, a lady that I've known for quite a while started to come. And in April of the next year, which would be last year, she joined the church. It was the first Sunday of April. She joined the church, and then on Resurrection Sunday, we had 2 ladies get baptized, and another lady yet joined the church. So now we've more than doubled our enrollment in the church in 1 month. So we're now up to 7 again, which is the highest number we've had for years. Now, God is starting to do some things, and people started coming. We were able to take on a new missionary this year. Had another guy start coming in November or December last year that I've known for a number of years, and he's a real blessing. Notice I said he, because up until now it's me and 6 women, and now I finally have a man in church, and that's a blessing also. A lot of churches are made up of women these days because men are not men enough to go to church.
Amen.
I'll say it one more time. Men are not men enough to go to church. They think they're being sissy by going to church. No, not true. You be a man, go to church.
Amen.
Worship the Lord.
Amen.
Be a Jesus lover.
Amen.
Amen. So anyway, he joined the church. Or he didn't join the church. He's been coming. I know he and his wife both, and I've worked with his wife in school. And she's not coming. We pray that she will. And he's waiting to see if she would come before he joins also, which I don't have any problem with that. But he's a great blessing. He's as good of a deacon as anybody could ever have. And he's not even a member of the church, not even a deacon, but he's a great deacon. And then January this year, met this fellow at Hometown Buffet, Old Country Buffet, if you will. And I've known his mom and dad for years, and all of a sudden he started joining them. He's a ripe 60 years old. He's had a triple bypass. He's fallen off of much taller buildings than what you and I want to think about, and tried to die many times. He has not succeeded yet. And his name is Marvin, so he's got to be an okay guy. Anyway, he started asking me, well, where's your church? He had gotten to the point where he is so sick and tired of churchianity instead of Christianity, he, as an evangelist, elected to quit going to church. He said, I've stayed home and I've studied my Bible and spent time in the Word rather than go listen to some phony baloney who doesn't want to stand in the Word of God, doesn't want to do anything for God. I don't think there's any churches like what I'm looking for around. And he walked in the building and he looked around and he went, wow, this place needs help. Then he heard me preach it. They really need help. No, really, surprisingly, he said, oh, hey, listen to this. This guy is talking up my alley. And so he got pretty excited about it. He has since joined the church. He and the other man are filling in for me while I'm here right now. And that's a blessing to be able to leave your congregation and know that your congregation is in good hands with people within your own church. That is really a thrill and a blessing to me. So we are now averaging about 15 on Sunday morning. I will tell you that I have one man, and he just shames everybody. And if it doesn't shame you, it should. He walks 2.5 hours one way every Sunday morning to come to church. He has 2 broken feet, and he must walk with a cane, and he walks every Sunday. He is as faithful as clockwork. In 20 months, he has missed one Sunday, and that was Mother's Day a year ago. That, to me, is a blessing, and I appreciate it. God's faithful. We have a building program going on. Like I said, this guy is the evangelist, but he's also he's a construction guy. He's built a lot of things. He knows how to draw drawings, and we decided that we were going to upgrade our bathrooms, and so I bought a new toilet for the ladies' room, and I put it in, and when I'm looking at the toilet, I'm looking at the floor, and I'm going, oh, my, this is horrible. I'm looking at the walls, it's the same old stuff that the other walls were made of. I'm looking at the ceiling, it's horrible. The whole thing is atrocious. So I talked to the church into letting me upgrade the bathrooms, and they agreed to do that. So I put the toilet in the ladies' room, decided we start with the men's room first, and just tear it out, just wipe it out and start all over again. Well, about this time I have another guy comes in. He can do everything. Oh yeah, I can do this. I'll make it beautiful. I got all in my mind exactly how I want it to look. Oh yeah, this is going to go there and that's going to go there. And he's got all these grandiose plans. Have at it, man. Knock the walls down. So he did. He knocked the walls down. Then he started putting it back together again. Don't know what you know about sheetrock, but you don't put the backside out. Don't know what you know about sheetrock, but you don't just put a piece up there that's 4 foot wide and then put the next piece right up next to it when the stud is over there and the sheetrock ends here and you just butt the next one up to it and no stud. You don't do that. This is the guy that knew how to do everything. So I just looked him in the eyeball one day and I said, you really have never sheetrocked before in your life, have you? Well, it's been a long time and I kind of forgot. No, you have never sheetrocked before in your life. Well, this other guy, this Marv guy, does know how to do that. And when he tried to correct it, and he was doing a pretty good job. He was really making that wall look like it was almost straight, and I knew it wasn't. And he was really doing a great job. And he quit for about 3 days. He wouldn't do anything. And all of a sudden, he came tooling in with a set of plans for 2 brand new bathrooms. And we're going to take 8 feet off the auditorium because the bathrooms, you had to get up and walk to the front of the church in order to go to the bathrooms. We're going to put it in the back of the church. So we took 8 feet. So right now we're a small congregation. We can afford to lose a couple of pews in the back. We're going to wind up by tearing the walls out and back and go back to the third wall. In the long run, we're going to gain 3 inches overall on the length of our auditorium. And we have 2 brand new facilities in the back so that when you walk in the church, you got nice facilities there, all modern, what have you, then you walk into this dungeon. But that's okay. It's getting upgraded. It's looking better. So now that I've told you what all is going on, by the way, the bathrooms are operational even right now as we speak. And that's phase one. We're going to put cathedral ceiling in. We also looked at the rafters up there, and every rafter in that building is split. How the roof has stayed up this long, I have no idea. God is gracious. That's all I can say. So we're going to put truss system in and put a peaked ceiling, a roof in, ceiling in, and just make it look a lot nicer. So that's what's going on out in California. Now, we got something going on here today. It's called a message. So if you would turn your Bibles, please, to Psalm 73, we'll get into the Word of God. God is good. If you don't know that, you need to learn it. The song that we sang, the songs that we've sung so far are really, really good. Pastor Calabretta had no idea what I was going to preach today, and those songs that he picked are really applicable. Sometimes the days seem long. We can get discouraged. And so the title of this message today is Then Understood I Their End, and in a minute you'll understand exactly what I'm talking about. Psalm 73, beginning in verse 1, if you stand together with me, please, as we read God's Word, in respect to God's Word. Psalm 73 and verse 1, the Bible says, Truly, God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped, for I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. Therefore pride compasseth them about as a chain. Violence covereth them as a garment. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. They are corrupt and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore his people return hither, and waters of a full cup are wrung out to them. And they say, How doth God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High? Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Verily I have cleansed my heart in vain, and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of thy children. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me, until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then understood I their end. Father, I pray, dear God, that you would bless this message this morning. That, Father, the words that fall out of this man's mouth are not the words of men, but the words of the Holy Spirit of God. And Father, may they fall on hearts that are obedient and receptive to the word that you have. And Father, may we understand better why we go through some of the things that we go through, and to realize that our faith is not in vain. Father, bless the message, I pray. Bless the listeners as well, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. The book of Isaiah in the Bible is often referred to as an outline of the Bible. It kind of breaks down this way. Isaiah has 66 chapters. The true Bible has 66 chapters. Each chapter can be viewed as an insight to one of the books in the Bible. For example, Isaiah chapter 1 is likened unto Genesis. Chapter 2 is likened unto Exodus. 3 unto Leviticus. On down to the 66th book, likened unto the book of the Revelation. Even the split between 39 and 40, the split between the Old Testament and the New Testament, it can be likened that way. And it's pretty marvelous to look at it that way. The book of, or the chapter, 73rd, no, the book of Psalms, I'm sorry, the book of Psalms can also be broken out in a similar fashion, only it's likened unto the Pentateuch. The Pentateuch is a nice 25-cent word, meaning the first five books of the Old Testament, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And this is how Psalms would be broken out if that were the case. Psalm 1 through Psalm 42 would be Genesis. It's all about man. Man is the subject matter of it. It deals with the blessedness of man. It deals with the fall of man. It deals with the redemption of man. Beginning in chapter 43 on through chapter 72 would be likened to the book of Exodus. Now the Exodus, of course, deals with the nation of Israel. It talks about both their ruination and their redemption. Beginning in chapter 73, going through chapter 89, I guess you call them chapters. Some don't take them as chapters because they're songs. Well, however you want to call them, Psalm 73 through Psalm 79 would be likened unto the book of Leviticus, which deals with the sanctuary, the tabernacle, the temple, the house of God. Psalm 90 through 106 would be likened unto the book of Numbers. It deals with the earth. It deals with Israel and the Gentiles. And then the 107th Psalm on through the 150th Psalm deal with the book of Deuteronomy. It would be likened unto the book of Deuteronomy, which deals with the perfection and praise. It has to do with God's word. So in this, the first book of Leviticus, if you will, if you break it down, section, the sanctuary is what is prominent. And that's what we're going to talk about just a little bit this morning. That is the conclusion of the message. The book of Leviticus is the book of worship for the tabernacle, later on the temple, and even now today the house of God. And as we begin, I need to ask you, if you ever wondered, ever asked yourself, why, if you are a child of God, do all these bad things happen to you? Now, I know you're righteous. I know that you would never think of any such a thing. But just suppose you had thought that way, okay? Do we have a right to question God? Absolutely not. No right at all. I have heard many people ask this, why, God? Why did this have to happen to me? Suppose Daniel thought about that in the lion's den? Suppose the three Hebrew young men thought about that? I mean, you know, as they were thrown into the fiery furnace? Why me, Lord? Well, why not you? When you suffer for the cause of Christ, it is a blessing to think that God would count you worthy enough to suffer for his cause. Instead of sucking our thumbs and pouting and feeling sorry for ourselves because things don't go the way we think that they ought to go, we ought to start considering, hey, you know what? Maybe this is exactly what God wants for me, and maybe I need to be a little bit happier about it. It's not easy to do that, I want to tell you. But through training, it can happen. You can look at it that way, and it makes life a whole lot easier. It's a lot nicer to go through life with a smile on your face than it is to go through life with a frown. Have you ever tried to witness to somebody with a frown on your face? How are you doing? I got sciatica, and my left arm is hurting, my foot's sore, and I got every ailment known to man from African mumps to dyspeptic hands. And then you're going to try, but let me tell you about Jesus. In the same attitude, you spoke about how bad you feel. How successful do you think you're going to be at winning someone to Christ? I will tell you, you won't. It just doesn't happen that way. All right? We need to put more faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, who promised that he would never leave us nor forsake us. That's a promise that he made to us. We have every reason in the world to smile. We have every reason in the world to be upbeat and be ready to tell others about Christ and be able to do that because our actions speak what we believe. God has promised much the same of these same words to Joshua. Remember who Joshua is? He's the fellow that took over for Moses. You know, those are big shoes to fill. Moses is he's a pretty good hitter, if you will. You know, he's the Mickey Mantle, if you will, of things in the Old Testament. And he's strong, and Joshua has been elected to take his place. And what did God say to him? He promised, he said, be strong and of good courage. So I'll be right there. I'm not going to let you down. Don't worry about it. Everything's going to be okay. Did Joshua obey? Yeah. Yeah, he sure did. All right? So anyway, we need to remember that we're not the only ones that these words were applicable to. They're applicable to us today as well. With this in mind, we're going to see that some other folks have a problem along that line. We've read about it here. This psalm was written by a fellow by the name of Asaph. Okay, not all the Psalms were written by David, by the way. And here's one that was written by Asaph. And I want you to notice that immediately our attention is drawn to something. He says, truly God is good to Israel. Truly God is good to Israel. It is no secret that the Israelites are God's chosen people. No secret at all. Whatever the psalmist, who again is Asaph, had been thinking, he concluded above all else that God loved the Israelites. And he did, indeed he does, and indeed he will.
Amen.
That's not going to change.
That's right.
They are God's chosen people, and we need to understand that. God has entreated Israel well. Even when they turned their back on him, he still entreated them well. And even though they have been dispersed, he has always, always kept his word to them. The covenants. Have you ever thought about the covenants? How many covenants are there? How many covenants did God make? Has God made with mankind?
Two.
Keep going.
Three. I haven't taught him that
yet. Haven't taught him that yet. Well, then you're about to learn something. There's eight. Eight covenants that God has given to mankind. The Edenic covenant, the covenant he made with Adam in the Garden of Eden before the fall. Then after they fell, he had to establish a new covenant. It was called the Adamic covenant. Then we went on to the Noahic covenant. Then we went to the Abrahamic covenant. Then we went to the Mosaic covenant. Then we go to the Palestinian covenant. Then we go to the Palestinian covenant. And then we go to the new covenant. The new one is the last one. That's the New Testament. That's why you came up with two, old and new. I'm reading you. I'm with you. But there were seven in the Old Testament. And every time there was a reason why he had to come up with a new covenant. Because man broke the old one. God never broke it, but man did. Every time. Now, that did not obliterate. It didn't wipe out the first covenant. There's still parts of the first covenant that are applicable today. There's still parts of all seven of them previous that are still applicable today. So because it was broken, it doesn't mean it was canceled. But a new one had to be established with a new person. Eden, Adam was perfect. Then he wasn't perfect. I had to reestablish it with him. What happened? Okay, Noah came along, had a flood, wiped out the whole earth. Now he's got to establish it with Noah. Okay, you follow me? Why these new covenants were necessary? But it was, why did God bring the flood? Because the wickedness of man was great upon the earth. That's why man broke the covenant. I got off on that. That's pretty good, though. And now let me get back to where I was talking about. The Israelites have broken their covenant with God. And they've been dispersed around the globe, and yet they're back together in their native land today. More and more and more, as we get closer to the time of Christ appearing, you'll see more Jewish people going back to the nation of Israel. And they're not going fast enough. They really aren't. You know why? Because they've got the albatross of the world hanging around their neck. They see the riches of the American state versus, you know, that's tough territory over there, but the best place for a Jew to be today is in Israel.
Amen.
It really is. There's no doubt in my mind about that. Anyway, it appears that Asaph had allowed his mind to stray to the prosperity of the wicked. And how often have you been caught up in that same thing? We all have jobs. How many times have you seen wicked people get advanced in their job over you? And I'll guarantee you everybody in here has seen that. That sometime or another, someone has gotten advanced that was wicked. They were, you know, they went out and they did things they weren't supposed to do, and they got promoted above you and what have you. And you wonder, why, God? You know, why didn't I get that promotion? I could have used that, you know, that increase in pay. I got my family to feed and what have you. And why him and not me? Well, you ought to think the other way. I'm glad it was him and not me, because I don't have the same headaches that he's got anymore. Because that's usually what happens. But, you know, God did not limit his goodness to the Israelites. But by the same token, it was to those Israelites that were of a clean heart that God is really good to. But even if we don't get that promotion that we think we deserve, doesn't mean that God doesn't love us. Doesn't mean that, you know, that that he's forsaken us because we don't get what we thought we deserved. Okay? So anyway, Asaph sees the world advancing, and he's down in the mouth about it, and we get the same problem. So it seems that from our standpoint point of view, they are the only ones that seem to get promoted. When I was 9 years old, I had an unfortunate occasion, and my mother lost a child. She was 5.5 months pregnant, and this little boy was not right physically. But to a 9-year-old boy, I did not understand that. But even less than that, there was a young lady in our town who was considered to be a loose girl, and she got pregnant out of wedlock, and about the same timing is what my mother did, and my mother lost her baby, and this young girl carried her child full term and turned out to be a beautiful little boy, what have you, and I did not understand. Why was it that that girl, who doesn't have any morals, she doesn't have any monetary backing, she doesn't have a home, she doesn't have anything, why did that child live and my brother not live? You know, I was looking forward to having a little brother to play with and what have you, and I didn't have that. Instead, I had to watch this other boy grow up. Not that I hated the child, because I didn't. I was glad that he was okay, but I didn't understand, why did my brother die? Why me? Why my family? And it affected me. It affected me for a number of years. It affected my mother. I saw my mother change, a new person, and I watched it as a 9-year-old boy. I watched her change over the rest of her life. Her heart was on that little baby that she had wanted to bring up. But you know what? God brought that child up. I know where that child is. That baby's in heaven with Jesus. He's brought up with Jesus, who did a whole lot better job than what my mother and I could have done, and my dad. And besides that, he didn't have the wicked influence of his older brother on him, so I know he's doing a lot better. I probably wouldn't have done such a good job. According to verses 2 through 4 here, Asaph is just about done in. It troubled him. He says, but as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well now slipped, for I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. There are no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. He was just about out of his mind. Why is this stuff happening? Why do the wicked prosper in their ways? However, he did not forget the principle of God's goodness. It seemed like a lot of Old Testament Bible characters had a certain principle of God that they stood on. For example, Job stood on the omniscience of God, how knowledgeable God is. Jeremiah stood on God's righteousness. Habakkuk, by the way, I got to get the pronunciation this right. For 7 years, I pronounced this Habakkuk. Do you know how you pronounce it? Habakkuk. Habakkuk. Never knew that, but that's how you're supposed to pronounce it. Habakkuk stood on God's holiness, and Asaph here stood on God's goodness. Here's a man who understood this goodness of God, and yet he says, my feet were almost gone, my steps had well slipped. The tempter had nearly tripped him up. And the tempter's trying to do the same thing to you today. He's trying to trip you up. Why was he trying to trip me? He said, for I was envious of the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Now, I don't think that his envy was just for himself. I think his envy probably spread across many families. He had witnessed many of the righteous doing without while the wicked prospered, and he really did not understand the thing. They always seem to have their swagger, the world does, to be able to entice a Christian to follow after them. You ever notice that? You know, they have a certain arrogance about them, a certain pride, they carry themselves. You know, we sit back, we go, we bite our fingernails once in a while, we wonder if everything's going to be all right. And they just seem to flow along like, you know, they got the world by the tail. We'll talk about that more in a minute, but it just seems like that's how it is. So sometimes when things are low, it's almost tempting to take that leap yourself. But God says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Amen. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Why do I have to fear? The answer is I don't. Get down into verses 5 through 7 here. Not only does Asaph see how the wicked prospered, but it also seemed to him that they were exempt from some of the troubles that he went through. Have you ever considered the wicked? You know, a lot of times in the wintertime, they don't get the flu like you do. Have you ever noticed that? You know why? Alcohol, will fight flu. That doesn't mean that you ought to go out and start drinking. It doesn't mean that at all. But I'm just telling you, you know, their wickedness sometimes does prevent them from getting some of the ills that we get. And it's true. Because they have more money, perhaps, because they have been exalted into higher places, then they eat a better food quality than what we do, and so they're healthier than we are. Lots of reasons why they do. And it seems like life just is good for them. They live on easy street while we struggle and worry about where the next meal is going to come from. They boast about their accomplishments. They brag about their kids. Their kids get in trouble with the law and they laugh it off. They're able to buy their way out of tickets and all kinds of things and think that they're doing something great for their kid. They're not, but they think that they are. Their children go to the best colleges. They get the best education. They get the best jobs. It says here that their eyes stand out with fatness, yet they are lean in their souls. They're ungodly, having all the pleasures of the world, the good seats at the ballpark. I love baseball. I really do. But I don't like to sit out there and, you know, the far end of the field where you can't see anything. I like to sit up close. But the expensive seats are up close. So they get all the good seats at the ballpark. I'm envious about that. They get the beautiful yacht at the marina, the sports car, the nice racing cars and what have you. You know, with all the power, the luxurious home, the good clothes that they wear. It seems that they just seem to be able to fare better than what we do. They go on smiling about it again, thinking that they got the world by the tail. And that's exactly what they have. They have the world, but they don't have the creator of the world. Amen. We have something far greater than what they do. Verse 8 through 11, or through 12, they're corrupt. They speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens. Their tongue walketh through the earth. Therefore his people return hither, and waters in full cup are wrung out to them. And they say, how doth God know? I can do anything I want to. How does God know? Because they don't realize that he's omniscient. They don't. And they say, is there knowledge in the Most High? Yeah, you better believe there is.
Yeah.
But look and see what's happening in the world. There's political unrest. There's economic unrest. There's military unrest. There's religious unrest. The world is calling for, you guessed it, a world government. A one world monetary system. So you got political, you got monetary. Military would be the same thing. United Nations is all about that. We're heading that way fast, folks. Uh-huh. Right down the tubes.
Right.
We have a president that is pushing us in that direction, and he wants to be the kingpin of the world. Don't you think for one second that he doesn't. Now that we've covered that, I'm just going to tell you that our president speaks with a forked tongue. He does. Out of this side you hear this, out of this side you hear that. It all depends. He claims to be a Christian. He is not a Christian that this book outlines. He is Muslim through and through, and I would deny him, I would defy him to tell me that I'm lying when I say that, because he is a Muslim. The United States, I don't know of anywhere in prophecy where the United States is spelled out. I know a lot of people that like to say that, well, we think this is the United States. Yeah, Hal Lindsey had a big handle on everything too a few years ago, and you know what? He doesn't have it any more than George Orwell did in writing his book in 1984. A lot of speculation. And we have known for years all of these things that were going to happen, but the only thing that we really know that's going to happen is that Jesus is coming.
Amen.
And we don't know when.
Wow.
But it could be right now. It could happen any moment. So that we do know. But anyway, I'm going to tell you right now that the next election that we have, if we have another election, will not be about Republican or Democrat. It's going to be about right and wrong. I can't believe that just this week, my illustrious state of California got shot down.
Yeah.
Two times we have been brought up before the people of the state of California to call marriage a union between one man and one woman. And now the United States Supreme Court, the highest court in our land, has said that move was unconstitutional. and that a man has a right to marry a man, and a woman has a right to marry a woman, and you know what? The United States just sunk itself to its lowest ebb ever. Don't care how powerful you think we are. I don't care how good you think we are. We're not. We are not good. We are not powerful. Our power is gone. It's done. So we can't wait until November of 2016 for the next election to take place, because that may never happen. What we need to do is that we need to be doing a daily thing, making sure that our hearts are right with God. It's got to start in here, folks, because there's not much you're going to do about what's going on out there. I cannot tell you how many times just this week I've heard, we know this is happening, but what can we do about it? What can we do about it? I imagine the German people felt the same thing around 1930 or 31. We see what's happening. What can we do about it? Well, America, you better wake up, because you got about 1 or 2 years left and you're heading down the tubes. You can write it down. This date right here, write it down. All right. Now, Asaph may have had a right to complain, but what did he do about it? And that's a good question. What can we do about it? Like I said, it's got to start in here. There's people that are lost and dying around us and going to hell. Are our lives being lived in such a fashion that we are the testimony that we need to be able to reach out to the lost and dying world and offer them Jesus Christ? And that's an erstwhile question. Are we? Okay? Our leaders, before I get to our leaders, I want to just tell you, it's amazing to me how all of these people got all the answers to everything. You have an economic woes, buy gold. Buy gold. Put your money in gold. Now let me ask you a question. Why? Why would you want to buy gold? Do you realize that we're going to trample gold under our feet in heaven? So why would I want to buy gold? Why do I want to buy a bunch of macadam? It doesn't make any sense to me. Well, the world says I can cheat you and I can get away with it. And they do. And they even think that they're cheating God, and they don't think that God knows about it. He does. They will pay. And you know it. But by the way, you know, this is our present-day politicians' concept. I can do anything I want to do. I can steal from the people. Nancy Pelosi, I hope you're listening. Harry Reid, I hope you're listening. If you think I only mentioned Democrats, I did. All right? And I don't want to apologize for you. I'm not a Republican either. I'm neither one of those. I don't want to have any affiliation with any of that crowd. But those two people right there, they just think they can get away with it. And Barack Obama, same goes with you. You can do anything and get away with it. You might do anything you want to and get away with it today, but there's coming judgment day one day for you. And you know what? You're going to burn in hell forever and ever and ever unless you repent of what you've done. That's all there is to it. And I don't apologize for saying that. They have no fear. They have no regard for God. Just going to do what they want to do, and that's it. They tax us to death, and they even smile about it while they're stealing from you and from your children and now your grandchildren and probably your great-grandchildren. I'll get on. I got to get off my soapbox here. Verse 13 says, "Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of their children." Isn't that true? If we stand up and say that homosexuality is wrong, we are guilty of a hate crime because we try to speak the truth. Your generation, my friend, is going to have to put up with that stuff. And I'm sorry. I apologize to you for how we have let you down. And I mean that. You kids, listen. You're in a generation that's going to bring you a lot of trouble. A lot of it.
Wow.
Asaph had gotten himself where he wondered, what's the use of serving God? It just doesn't look like it pays. Think I'd just throw in a towel. Now, don't tell me you've never been there before. And if you haven't, then it's either because you're a liar or you're blind or else you're about to get into it. Because it's here. It's all around us. Okay? So it's a good thing you're here this morning. Listen to that. Don't worry. God's still in charge. All right? Don't fret. He is. He's still in charge. And he always will be. All right? What Asaph faced was almost enough to cast us for him to cast aside his relationship with God. That's how downtrodden he had gotten. And just say, forget the whole thing. And this, by the way, is an age-old devil's trick. He wants you to get discouraged. He wants you to look around you and see all the things that are going on around you. And he wants you discouraged and down so that you can go, well, like my evangelist friend, why even bother to go to church anymore? Because there's no churches that want to stand the word of God. That's not true, first of all. And he was wrong. He was dead wrong. And I think he's finding that out now. But he's getting himself squared away, and he's doing a fine job. Anyway, he wants to get us discouraged. He knows, as Christians, he will never, ever have us. But if he can get us discouraged to where we are ineffective, then he's as good as got us. Huh. Yeah. We aren't being used for what God designed us to be used for if we're not being used for him. So, what happens? Believe me when I tell you, there's a lot of Christians today that are discouraged and downtrodden. A lot of them. A lot of us. Maybe I should say us instead of them. Don't go to church. Don't read their Bibles. Don't pray. Don't witness. Don't do anything. They just don't. They don't anything. And that's a real shame. They're rendered completely useless by God because they're useless for God because of discouragement or disappointment or some other meant except what they were meant to be. Okay, that's what happens to them. Verse 14, he says, for all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. Yeah, you think? Yeah, he sure was. He knew that what he was thinking wasn't right. He had a right to be plagued. Yet it seemed to consume his thought. And it's not a vain thing to serve the Lord, folks. I want you to know that. It is not a vain. John Bailey, I am so happy with you. I am just thrilled to pieces to think of what you're doing. Because I see a little church. Listen to me, folks. I see a little church in upstate New York who's a pastor, got a pastor that is stuck firm by the stuff year after year after year. Talk about opportunity for disappointment. It's been right here in this room. In this very room. And now, many years later, we are seeing a product coming out of this church. A man of God being caught up and brought up to take to the world the word of God. And John, it's just a
glory.
Thank you, preacher. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you, John. Dave, I've worked with you for years and years and years, and I've seen your faithfulness to Christ. Thank you. Thank you, Tony. Thank you. It hurts when you see people falling by the wayside. It's not a vain thing to serve the Lord. Paul faced the same thing when he wrote to the Corinthians to forgive me. But he wrote to them in 1 Corinthians 15:58. Turn in your Bible there, hold in 50. Here in Simon, turn to 1 Corinthians 15:58. I'm going to tell you, I know a preacher, a friend of mine, he's in heaven now. His name is Grant Rice. He spent his whole entire life preaching this verse right here. I don't believe there's a message that that man ever preached. He didn't start out with 1 Corinthians 15:58. He would come in like this. Every service, he said, hold your Bibles up. All right, now turn this way. I want to see if there's any gold left on those pages anymore. If there's gold in there, I know you're not reading it. And then he said, turn your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Did you get that? Your labor is not in vain in the Lord. There's a song that's entitled that, and I don't sing it too well, but I'm going to do my best to sing it for you this morning. And I hope it'll be a blessing. We have labored in the vineyard of the Lord, and it seems the world has stolen our reward. But God has not forgotten, and when he calls us home, we'll receive eternal treasures and a place of honor near his throne. It's not in vain, it's not in vain. We serve a risen Savior. Jesus rules and reigns. The heavens cheer us on. We do not walk alone. Our labor, our witness, our faith, it's not in vain. God has seen our faithful witness through the years. All the heartaches, all the burdens, all the tears. So do not be discouraged. There's a purpose, there's a plan. There's a reason for each trial. So trust the leading of his hand. It's not in vain. It's not in vain. We serve a risen Savior. Jesus rules and reigns. The heavens cheer us on. We do not walk alone. Our witness, our labor, our faith, it's not in vain.
Amen.
Sorry, I didn't do a very good job of singing that. I got kind of choked up. I'm kind of emotional this morning. Verses 15 to 16, the psalmist is able to keep his feet under him. He said, if I say I speak thus, behold, it should offend against the generation of children. When I thought to know thus, it was too painful for me. And in verse 17, here's the reason why it is necessary to go to church. Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I therein. You're not going to get understanding of the disappointments of this world out there. You're not going to gain it out there. You're going to find it in the house of God. That's why it's important to find yourself faithful to the house of God. Every time the doors are opened of your church, you should be open. Be an encouragement to your pastor. I cannot tell you how much I love that man right there. He is such a blessing to me, such an encouragement to me. It's just a thrill to have a man like that as my friend. I don't know even why he likes me, but I'm glad he does. I guess he feels sorry for me. Maybe that's it. I don't know. I don't think so. But I appreciate him. Here, Asaph was able to see past the end of his nose and even past the end of their lives, and he could see what lies in store for those who seem so prosperous here. Someone said, if I knew who it was, I'd tell you who it was, but I don't know who it was, but they made this comment. It is so true. The very worst a Christian will ever have to face, they will face on this earth. But for the world, the very best that they will ever face, they will face on this earth. Can you imagine this being the best that you could look at for eternity? That ought to be enough to make anybody want to get saved. It really should, because this world is wicked. The saved have heaven to look forward to, but the lost have nothing but hell. Then the psalmist felt grief for his frailty. His heart was grieved, and he was pricked in his reins. The apostle Paul understood it. He also wrote in Philippians 1:6, being confident of this very thing, that he that hath begun a good work in you. Now listen to me. He that hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Who's going to perform it? Who's going to perform it? Jesus is going to perform it. It's not you anyway. It's not you to begin with. It's all about Christ. The whole thing, he's the one that's going to perform it. You just have to step aside and let him. And that's exactly what you've done, John. Praise God for it. It's what you've done. It's what you've done. On and on. Others, listen, we serve our risen Savior. Our labor is not in vain. We have every reason in the world to be encouraged rather than discouraged. That's my message. Pastor, will you come up and close it out as you see fit?
Thank you. Alrighty. We're going to stand and sing on the 286, Almost Persuaded. 286.
Somewhere, isn't it?
Almost persuaded how to believe. Almost persuaded Christ to receive. Seems now some soul to say, go.
God's got better things for you. You don't need to be discouraged.
Amen.
The world around us looks so wonderful, glittering, prosperous, a false sense of happiness that they have. You might be almost persuaded to believe what Brother Lamos said for you. Don't leave. Don't tell the Holy Spirit to leave you alone. Go, Spirit, go thy way. Let him speak to your heart today. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, you have assembled us together today to hear this message. For we know Satan wants to stop and discourage us any way he can, because he knows if he can stop us, then the gospel won't go out like it does. Lord, day after day things go wrong. Day after day we see other people doing better than us, seemingly. Lord, may our faith, our joy be in you. May we understand that we can come into your sanctuary daily as we open up your word and see their end, which is a sad thing. But we can also see our end, which will be a joyous thing if we live right before you. Lord, it takes faith. For those fiery darts of Satan come at us every way, but that shield of faith will protect us. So I thank you for Brother Lamos's message. Just bless him and his church. And it won't be but just a few, maybe an hour or two that they'll be starting out there on the West Coast. And so just use them. Please, my Lord, would you help his sister in the hospital? And take care that the doctors and nurses be able to help her and her health needs. Do some great things in her pain. Thank you again, Lord, for children. May they grow up understanding that big doesn't have to be better.
That's right.
that having God behind them is the greatest thing.
Amen.
So may they live for you. It's not going to be easy. Just help them. Thank you again for your love to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen, dear ones. Lord bless you. And if God's spoken to you, take the time to take care of it.